Please be seated. Breaking news. Breaking news. Things are bad out there. I saw breaking news several times this week, sadly. Wasn't it sad? How people at the height of their very successful, very talented, very intelligent and articulate and engaging, how people at the height of everything the world has to promise can not hear voices of love, voices of light, cannot hear perhaps God's voice speaking above the voices of the world, and they make the ultimate decision to give back the gift that God gave to them. We've got some younger ears, so I just want to make sure everyone understands who we're talking about. Did you see the news this week? New York City, Paris, right? Doing the things that brought them all the success in the first place. Breaking news. All of a sudden, we think we have a problem. Did you hear? All those well-meaning interviewers? Why? There must be a problem since two celebrities made this decision. What do you think is contributing to this recent phenomenon? Really? I saw 25%, Emily 35%. In the past 20 years, the dramatic rise of making that ultimate decision. Everybody with me? Breaking news? Really? How about the good news? Christians, we have better. We always have better. We have a deeper root that dives down deep into the soil of God's wisdom. You know better. We have resources. It's not breaking news to us. And in this world that is so chaotic and so tumultuous, how many nations in the G6? Five and a half. In this world where there's breaking news every 10 minutes, the readings today remind us about how to appropriately respond to God's presence in our lives. They're dramatic reminders. It's not breaking news. It's good news. We have good. We have the best news. And sometimes we look and sound pretty foolish and pretty different. And that's okay. Genesis. I'm starting a book by Bruce Feiler, one of my favorite Gen X authors. And it's Adam and Eve, the title, The First Love Story. And Genesis, you get the story, it picks up right after Adam and Eve have eaten of the fruit, the one thing, they must have been Episcopalian, the one thing God tells them not to do, they race immediately past the tree of life to do the one thing that God says not to do. The very definition of Episcopal Christians. They're in the Garden of Eden. God has provided for them everything they need. Women can give birth without pain. Men can harvest without labor. It's everything in perfect unity, perfect harmony with the creation. No fires, no Ebola, no none. It's all perfect. And they make a major mistake. And the first thing they do, when God, the Genesis writer says, with a great deal of flourish, comes walking through his garden in the cool of the afternoon, they hear God approaching. And what do? They hide, but they hide something else. Oh my God, he might see this. Now friends, it's only Victorian English Victorian English that rushed to paint those stupid little leaves over every sexual organ that was so beautifully painted in the Renaissance, right? To cover up Or those little napkins? Really? I mean, seriously, right? You're gonna paint over that? I mean, that's amazing. And I've never read this before, how comedic it is. As if God's gonna say, what the heck's behind that? I've never seen, oh dear, what is that? I've never seen that before. How did they think of that? Really? The first response of Adam and Eve to God's presence, God's presence is shame. They are ashamed. This is why God said not to eat that. Their response to everything God has given them is complete shame, and they want to run and hide. That is exactly the wrong response to God's presence and God's giving. Let's try the New Testament. Can the Corinthians do any better? I'm hopelessly stuck on Paul. The older I get, the more I preach to you, the more Paul becomes a person who is profoundly speaking to my life. Paul founded the church in Corinth. It's a rising, hot millennial hotbed of the first century. Athens, dusty and boring. Corinth is where the action is. Paul spent over 2 years in Corinth. He worked. He never asked for a dime. He loved this church into existence. He put his life at service to their needs. He preached the gospel in the synagogue, on the street, in the port. He preached it in the marketplace. He converted. He brought to faith officials, slaves, dock workers, women, men, and he built this church. And he left to go on to the next place. And we know now that other teachers followed Paul. They were more attractive physically. They were much more articulate. They spoke beautifully. They said to the Corinthians, that guy, he gave you the first part, but we've got the real wisdom about Jesus. Paul is devastated. He's given them his whole life. You know what they write back to him in a letter? They say, well, if you come back, maybe we'll let you talk in the church if you bring a letter of recommendation. These teachers, when they came into town, had a really slick PR campaign. They had letters of recommendation from other churches. Paul, by the way, at this point is in prison. He's chained to a wall. There's no privy. There's no bathroom. There's no food unless someone brings it to you. Paul is in the depths of despair. He's shattered and broken. He gets this letter and he says, is this what I've given my life for? Are these the kind of people that I shared God's love? And this is what I get back. Let's try the gospel. How are we doing? Breaking news. Let's try the gospel. Jesus is healing people. He's healing lepers. He's reviving people that look like they've died. He's healing people that have epileptic fits. That's pretty impressive now, by the way. He is bringing marriages together. He's blessing children. He's feeding people miraculously. He's speaking to the natural world like a rabbi spoke to a student. And the religious professionals, the PhDs, the people that study the Bible every day, what do they say? You heard it 7 minutes ago. What did they say about Jesus? The religious professionals say he's a demon. He's the son of Satan, basically. Beelzebul is the Hebrew term. And he can do this because he's evil. He's demon-possessed. That's what they said. Watching Jesus do all this miraculous stuff. That's That's what they have. His family comes to him. Why? Because they hear rumors, and the rumors are that Jesus has gone crazy. Now, let's just talk about family for a second. Family are the people that can actually tell you that you've gone crazy, evidently. They come to Jesus concerned for his mental health. This is what I read it to you just 6 minutes ago. How are we doing? Breaking news? Can you imagine God in heaven with God's hands that don't really exist, but let's imagine them? And God says what God says in Hebrew, oy vey. Let's not do breaking news. How about we run this with good news? Shall we? Everybody ready? Good news in the garden. What would that look like? Would they do this? Would you do this? What is good news? Union with God. Full harmony, right? Nothing blocked. Let's give it a try. Oh, I love this. This is great. Because nothing is going to get in the way of me and God. I tell you what, it's just so awesome. I want God to see all the warts. All the warts. Because God created all this in the first place. This is available for God. I'm telling you what. So let's just, hold on. I'll be with you in just a second, Noah. So we're just going to get rid of this. And we're going to look at God. God's going to look at us. He's going to know everything there is to know about us. I'll be with you in just a second. All right. Oh, look at the time. We don't have time. God wants this. God created and knows all of us. The Bible says that there's one person that can hear our inmost thoughts. It's not Satan. It's not your spouse. Unless you're a guy, then yeah, they know our inmost thoughts. God knows our inmost thoughts. God can hear us on the inside. The psalmist says, there is forgiveness with the Lord. Therefore, he is to be feared or awestruck. Is not the essence of the Bible, the essence of the good news, forgiveness and healing? Physical healing? Emotional healing, spiritual healing, relational healing, and yes, friends, Bruce Feiler, sexual healing. Intimacy. At the deepest level, it's safe. It's beautiful. It's life-giving. That's what God wants with us and with each other. That's the good news. Not breaking. Can we run Corinthians for just a second? How about the Corinthians? Can you hear me? How about the Corinthians? How about the Corinthians saying, we're not going to look on the outside, we're going to listen to God's voice through the greatest Christian teacher besides Jesus that ever lived. How about Paul in prison writing a letter back to the Corinthians saying some of the most profound things that you will ever read in the Bible? He said, do you want a letter of recommendation? He said, I've already written it. It's you. Paul wrote to the Corinthians in reply. He said, you are my letter of recommendation. It's not on a page. It's written in the human heart. He said, the good news is written inside of you. He said, you're the best thing I'll ever do. I resonate beyond being a father and a husband with those words. You're the best thing I'll ever do. That's what Paul said. Paul said, we hold this extraordinary power in clay jars so that everyone knows it's God and not us. It doesn't matter how eloquent we are. It doesn't matter what we look like. Paul says, actually, it's the suffering that unleashes God's power. Paul wrote, he heard God say to him, in prison, my strength is perfected in your brokenness. That's the depth of the good news. And people that we heard this week that make that ultimate decision, they don't know that there's more to the story than pain and suffering. Somehow they can't hear it. And it's one of the worst wounds of the Christian church when someone cannot hear God's voice, right? Paul said, our inner nature is being renewed even as our outer nature needs an extreme makeover. Day by day, Paul said, if I'm in prison, I'm not losing hope. What excuse do you have? Richard Rohr says, I'm quoting Richard Rohr. Stop the YouTube video. I'm quoting Richard Rohr. Richard Rohr says, without the suffering and the brokenness, how can we hope to go further on the journey? It's part of the human experience. One way or another. I'll tell you. Finally, can we run the good news with that gospel reading? This sermon changed from veil to here, by the way. Where's the good news in the gospel reading? What is Jesus' mother, unnamed, her name's Mary, but not here, brothers and sisters, what do they do when they hear that one of the family members that they love has gone out of his mind? What do? They medicate, right? Oh, no, I'm sorry. No. Boarding school? No, no. Hold on. What do? They go to where he is. They stay with him. They go stand with him. Now, he gives a teaching about who our real family is, but just think about that for a second. How much love do they display to go with the person in their family that's hurting? Now, I don't know about your family, but sometimes in my family, the person that was hurting was invited to get a grip, figure it out, come back. Well, and sometimes family stood with it. Families are families. But just imagine the risk that they took to come stand with the person that they loved. They were being invited into a deeper relationship with the Son of God, and they didn't even know it. That's good news. Sometimes we're being invited in this family, and we don't know it. That's good news. That's news the world will never understand. You'll never hear that on a TV broadcast. Because it's true, and it's important. Friends, don't go for breaking news. You have better. You have the best news of all. In the name of God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit. Amen.